Yo, it's your boy. I am back at it again. And lucky for me, my boy stopped by again, Mr. Movie. And today we're not going to talk about movies.
I'm sure we're going to actually end up talking about movies, but we're not going to start off by talking about movies or TV.
He's probably right. That's probably what's going to happen. It always leads to movies, because I always say everything that is culture is culture, and culture is part of movies. And unfortunately for us, what we watch on a daily basis, whether it's in the theater or at home, it affects us. I really think it makes a difference in our lives and the way we behave, our children behave, and just overall society behaves. I mean, what do you think about that, Jeremy?
It's certainly what we're exposed to is important. Good, bad, or ugly. I don't think it's a stretch. Just like if we have a good first grade teacher or a bad first grade teacher, we're going to have a different opinion, a different thought about what was my experience in elementary school. The teachers all sucked.
Yeah.
Put me in a bad mood.
I would love to blame them. I'm just a shitty student. Mrs. Hack, you were awesome. Mr. Min, you're a nice man. You guys were all awesome. Mr. Hill, I missed you. You were the best. I had some really, really teachers who actually cared and tried. And I was just, all I did was draw and make art. And what you're looking in front of you is all I drew all day long, basically.
Yeah, so. You probably needed a private school, maybe an art-centric private school to further your development.
That would have been nice.
Yeah, I had a couple of really bad teachers that hated children. And you wonder why anybody who hated children would be in a teaching profession, but that's neither here nor there. But at least two of my elementary school teachers, I think, should have been kept away from children because they just hated kids.
Really?
Hated them. Mrs. Benowitz, fourth grade, anybody who knows me from Massapequa who went to Fairfield, that woman was a nightmare, and she hated children. Mrs. Papora, sixth grade, who I mentioned a few weeks ago, last week, hated children, clearly despised them. But Benowitz, fourth grade, she specifically hated smart kids.
Well, she would love me.
Yeah, but she really didn't like much of anything. She liked opera. I got to go to a couple of operas because of her. That's the only nice thing I'll ever say about that woman. We went to the Metropolitan Opera House. We went to Lincoln Center. So I was exposed. We talk about culture.
Yeah.
That is something that is good. A good part of culture, which is, wow, this really exists. This is only a little close to my dad's office. I didn't know this was, you're a little 9 or 10 year old boy. So there's different kinds of culture, not just popular culture,
right?
But different kinds of culture. If we're fortunate, as I was, we're exposed to different kinds, and that can help shape us. So the fact that I can say that I went to two operas, well, it makes me sound more worldly than I might otherwise, but I'm glad that I had that experience. And so in the case of what Kenny was saying just before about maybe not paying attention, but drawing, hey, I was daydreaming too. Yeah. I wasn't drawing as a small boy. But I just as often was not paying attention to what was going on, even with the teachers that were not lousy teachers. I was thinking of other stuff. I was thinking about the Yankees in 1981, or I was thinking about, boy, I wonder if what today's episode of Spider-Man, the animated series, what's it going to be?
It's funny you say, because for me, if it wasn't Ninja Turtles and Hulk and all that, I matured very early on. So shout out to my friend Jim Kurtz. We were the only two boys that matured way before everybody else. So we weren't looking at our teachers like they were teachers at the time. So we were thinking about other things. And it's funny now as an adult, I look back and I'm like, wow, like that was really early on. But I think we were in third grade. I think my boy Danny, he had his dad had a Playboy with that girl from Different Strokes in it. And I was like, oh, you got to bring it to school, man. You got to bring it to school.
That's great. Different Strokes. Wink, wink, nudge, nudge.
Yeah.
Dana Plato.
Yeah, Dana Plato.
Unfortunately,
right.
Died very young. Not good. She's been gone at least 3 decades.
Why are you depressed at a happy situation?
Oh, sorry. That's me. Gloomy Gus.
So you bring them to school. You know, where are you supposed to look at this damn thing? So we're on the field for a recess. And, like, you know, we're enjoying ourselves. Like, oh, man, she's, oh, this is awesome. And lo and behold, teacher comes over. We're like, oh. She's like, what is that? Like, we found it. We don't know where it is.
We found it in a field.
Yeah. Danny's freaking out.
It was under the jungle gym.
Danny's like, that's my dad's. He's going to kick my ass. I'm like, oh, I'm sorry, bro. But thanks for bringing it in. I really appreciate it. So that was just, you know, I was, daydreaming about women a lot when I was a little, I guess I was in third grade at that time, bro. And, what were you like in high school? Were you like just quiet, rowdy?
Well, my first, I don't know if you can use the word crush, but I guess the first time I fixated on a young lady, I was actually in kindergarten. Now, I was not having sexual thoughts.
Yeah, you're a crush. Yeah.
Right. I didn't start having that level of, or those kinds of thoughts till when you would think, seventh, eighth, ninth grade. Right.
Yeah.
But no, I was loud with certain people. So the problem for me was that I was a bit of a tweener. I didn't really fit in with the jocks, to use a quote from, I don't even know if they still use that, but the people, the boys who were playing sports, or people in general playing sports, because I knew plenty of girls who were very into athletics, whether it was girls lacrosse or track or anything like that. I didn't really fit in with the nerds, and I didn't really fit in with the jocks, and I didn't really fit in with the popular crowd. So I was often left to my own devices. And, you know, this is where you can form certain opinions and ideas about life, which seem to be, or at least fit what you're going through at a certain point in life.
Yeah, definitely.
And then either you have experiences that maybe they change you. So the thing with change is that happens real slow, at least in my case.
Yeah.
Like, it's not wake up one day and all of a sudden, you know, I went to sleep last night and I really like this girl and now I hate her. But things happen and you're often not even aware that your thoughts are changing. And sometimes it's stupid, speaking of like pop culture, where when I was a little kid, I thought the original Batman series with Adam West, oh, was that fun?
Oh, bam. We all loved that. I loved it, but I'd always, it's really weird. So you love watching it, but then I get bored after a while. Because it wasn't very actiony, and there was poo, pow, pam in that. But there was no, I guess it wasn't really violent. It was kiddish, you know?
Yes. So that's something that when I revisited later, I was like, this show is not even good.
Childish. Yeah.
Right, which is fine.
Yeah.
Because, see, this is a thing, as we talk about pop culture, the good, the bad, and the ugly. There are certain pieces of pop culture that maybe we didn't appreciate when we were younger, that if we catch them later, we say, oh, I get it now.
Definitely.
Sometimes, as you said, when we saw The Exorcist.
Oh, my God. Totally different appreciation.
And this is why, you know, I said I knew we would bring up movies, but this speaks to not just culture, but your life. And, for example, if you and I, as much younger people, let's say in the late 90s, you and I ended up going to see The Exorcist when it came out into theaters. You weren't a father yet. I was always like that. Oh, fuck this, fuck this. There's no way you would have cried.
No, are you kidding me? I shocked myself this time.
But life.
Yeah.
Experiences changed how you perceive the exact same material. And it's not something that, okay, well, Kenny at age 28 would have reacted this way. And at age 36 this way. Never. There's no way to know.
No.
You weren't expecting it. And the movie, you would have had the same takeaway seeing it, let's say, if you saw it for the first time at 18. Wow, what a great movie. We left the theater. What a great movie.
Yeah.
But there are different pieces of it that hit different now.
Yeah, it's funny. If you don't know what he's talking about, so we went to go see the 50th anniversary of The Exorcist. If you haven't seen it, go to the last YouTube podcast and just put it up. And it's already on Apple iTunes and Spotify. But I don't know what I was expecting. I remember a really good movie, and I remember they love the effects and stuff. What caught me off guard was at least 3 times I cried. Like, I broke down. And, thinking about it, still thinking me over that.
Right, this is what I'm saying. This is
because I love my daughter right now. This podcast is called KPC and JPC. Like, she's a part of me. She's even part of my, her name is on the
podcast. Let me just hold you up for 1 second. People asked if my middle initial was P. A week ago, I said, what? What do you mean? They said, well, you're Jeremy Cohen.
Oh, my God, that's so true.
I said, that's not, you thought, no, that's just, what? P. For record, for the the record, my middle name is Scott. So it would have had to have been JSC. But I didn't I hadn't even thought of that till somebody says, "Oh, you're in that." No, I'm not. That's a very... What did you think my middle name was?
Peter.
I mean, Peter Patrick. No.
That's really funny. No, that's how much a part of my life she is. That so, in the movie, when the mother was just looking at the daughter and not knowing what to do, like, you know, she's taking every psychiatrist, every doctor, and they're like, "Whoa, it could be a lesion." I was angry. I'm like, "You mother."
Exactly. Okay. Now Ken was sitting in front, one row in front. But there's that, and it's such a great moment. And the actors who played the doctors were all great. They all seemed like real doctors. Yep. And when it's like the girl has had a spinal tap, and we've seen her with the blood, it's so horrifying. Again, talk about it being a horror movie, but the medical reality of what Regan McNeil in the world of the movie goes through.
Yeah.
And then she goes through this horrendous series of tests, and it's so bad. Again, as somebody who is a father, there's no way that you're not thinking in terms of, well, how would I be dealing with this? And then after this unbelievable series of just horrible, when she says, "What's wrong with my daughter?" And the way the doctor goes, "We still think it's the temporal lobe." And it was almost as if he was screaming, "What the fuck are you talking
about?"
That's
when you want to smack a motherfucker. You're like, excuse me? But the thing is, Jeremy, actually, I have never really... I guess I never talked about this. And if you see the end of the podcast that I made yesterday?
Yeah.
So I don't talk about this much because it's, I'll be honest with you guys, it's kind of funny. My brother died a few years back. And I almost refuse to speak about it. Many things are surrounding it are reasons why, but I kind of just close myself off to it. And, that movie brought back some memories, and it was really weird because I haven't even thought about it. And I really don't think about it much. I have his picture with me all the time. You know, I miss him. He was like my tail. Like, wherever I went, he was with me always. So for many years, like, I'd get out of the car, then open the back door, and there's nobody there. I'm like, "Oh, shit, that's right, he's not here." But he didn't die in normal circumstances. And I had to go through that. Where I asked the doctor, "Can you explain to me why 8 of you cannot hold down a 120-pound man who's all bones, and he could throw you off like you're flies, and he's on general fucking anesthesia?" And he looked at me and he goes, "No, I don't know what to say to you. I don't know how he's awake." So things that the girl went through in that movie, the tests... Man, I've seen it all from, like, being opened up and spinals. And, you know, it's really funny. My brother was a very brave human being. He never said, "I'm scared, don't." He goes, "That's okay. That's all right." He put up with so much shit, and he suffered. He suffered more than you can ever imagine in your worst nightmares. And that last night, I heard his bones crack. You know, I felt things snapping in my hands, and it was, like I said, if you saw the podcast at the end, good guys don't always win.
Right.
It's not how it works, unfortunately. Maybe if I knew what I know now, but, you know, that's life, unfortunately, and at least he's at peace. But the movie brought back that for me, which I have never, I rarely speak about, even to... You can ask Jamie, anybody. I don't really talk about it. John, anybody. I don't.
But look, the last week when you talked about some of your experiences, you know, with your marriage and...
Yeah, I don't talk about that much either.
Single dad, but it's like, we hear the word triggered, and there's different levels. But see, to me, I take the old school interpretation of it, which is just that... We can be exposed to something. It doesn't even have to be pop culture. It could be something as simple as crossing the street and we're reminded of something in our past. It could be good. It could be bad. But then it puts us back into that mindset. And watching the movie, it's an emotional movie for a so-called horror movie.
Yeah.
But and this, again, we talk about the power of movies and what they can do.
Absolutely.
He did not in any way expect it to be almost a cathartic...
No. I've seen so many of our movies after that, but for some reason, you know, there was the acting. she looked and made me feel the way I felt.
Right. And the with the makeup that they did to Ellen Burstyn, now obviously she didn't look like hell the way, no pun intended, the way Linda Blair with the wounds and the coloring and all of that. But it's another movie like Rosemary's Baby where, and that's more of a straightforward horror film that also deals with demonic possession, but from a different angle.
Yep.
And in Rosemary's Baby, the main character of Rosemary, Mia Farrow, who was just a kid at the time, is that you see the physical manifestation of the soul-wrecking horror that her body is undergoing through this, just to call it a difficult pregnancy would be a very big understatement.
Yep.
But you see the color in every scene slowly starting to seep from her face. And what they did in The Exorcist with Chris McNeil, played by Ellen Burstyn, who, as we said, is in the new Exorcist, is that they just very subtly were pulling color. Well, they were adding it to make, but it comes across as if this woman, doesn't matter that she's loaded, we know she's got a lot of money, she is slowly dying because her daughter is slowly dying.
Yeah.
And that's the level of devastation. And you know, we get caught by surprise. We don't expect things to take place.
The only other movie that really just spoke to me like that was The Exorcism of Emily Rose, if you guys have ever seen it.
I have seen that.
Miss Carpenter, Jennifer Carpenter's daughter, the girl from Dexter.
Sure.
His sister. She was good in the movie, but there's a scene in the movie where she confronts Mother Mary and she says, "Why? Why me? You know, her bones are breaking, she's suffering, she can't eat, she can't do anything." She's like, "I don't understand. Why me? And she said, "Listen, you have a choice. Come with me right now, it'll be over. But you can stay and tell the whole world that evil is real. And if evil is real, then God is real. That's your choice. You can choose to show the world the truth, or you can just go with me and end your suffering." And I think staying behind and trying to show people that things are real is much braver than just leaving. That's the truth, I'll be honest. I wish my brother had actually not had to suffer. That was the worst part about it, to watch night after night after night after night. My God, in this basement I'm sitting in now, how many times he was rolling around the ground, being pulled from one side to another side. And we would blame him. "What are you doing? What's wrong with you?" And he's holding his neck and we're like, you know, he's being choked. And we're like, "Stop choking yourself." Like, when you're ignorant, you know, and you don't know what's going on, you don't know things, this is what happens. And by the time we found out, it was just too late, unfortunately. So nothing much I could really do. And we were able to help other people after that, which is nice. So,
and it just reminded me that, again, this is a very depressing topic, but The Exorcist is a movie that is very depressing.
Well, and remember, it was based on a true story, too.
Yeah, right? And it has its, spoiler alert, it doesn't end brutally. I mean, it does and it doesn't, but there is a bit of a moment where we see, obviously, that not that all's well that ends well, but where things do improve to some extent.
I think it was a happy ending, in my opinion. She got to live her life, and she was young.
Right.
She got to move on with her life.
But what you were just talking about with your brother, the movie called Lorenzo's Oil, which was another one, which is based on a true story of a boy named Lorenzo Adone.
Okay.
Who had a degenerative neurological condition, which rendered him almost completely, he couldn't do anything. He went from being like a high-achieving 6 and 7 year old boy to being bedridden very, very quickly. And in the movie version, which was pretty close to the reality, as far as I understand, you know, they were able to cast big actors. Nick Nolte played, and Susan Sarandon, they played a husband and wife. This was their son in the film. Wow. And the conventional medical wisdom for this particular condition, it's about 20 letters, I can't pronounce it. But if you look up the movie Lorenzo's Oil, or if you look up Lorenzo Adone, you'll see it. None of the doctors could do anything. They had the wrong idea. And the character Nolte plays in real life was a scientist. He was Italian. He spoke with a heavy Italian accent. And Nolte did a decent job with the accent. But the assumption was, this guy doesn't know what the hell he's talking about. Mm-hmm. But he figured out a treatment protocol that nobody else had come up with because he had the science background. But there's this terrible moment where their son is starting to show improvement. But they realize it's too late for him. And Nick Nolte, who, you know, we see him now, remember that famous picture of him with the hair out to here, and he's now he's like this wacky old guy, like not to Gary Busey level. I mean, Busey I met, but when people, unfortunately, now think of Nolte, they think of that crazy, like, mugshot or whatever it was. It's got great hair, but still. Nolte has this really heart-ripping moment as a father where he looks at Susan Sarandon and he says, we're helping somebody else's kid, basically.
Yeah, that's what it is. That's what you're absolutely right about.
And that. And he's not throwing it back, but that wasn't why he was doing it. He was trying to help their son. And they did help him, but because they didn't start the treatment soon enough, because there was no treatment, they ended up pioneering some treatments for later people.
Yeah, it's in God's hands. Well, you know, back to the other topic, we're just gonna go down a more depressing lane. I don't wanna do that, so we were talking about school right before, even middle school and high school.
Yeah.
You know, something I never have done, and I'm really sorry. I actually wanted to, I gotta say this out loud, actually, on a podcast, and I guess this is where I bare my soul. I want to apologize to my friends. I had a few very good friends in school. Jeff was an amazing friend. Rokes, Dan. These guys were, like, always there for me. Clarissa and a few other people, even Priya. And I hated high school so much that when I left high school, I wanted to forget it even existed. And that meant forgetting everybody existed. And I just kind of started a whole new life, completely different. Sometimes I feel bad. It's like I left my friends behind, didn't even bother asking if they're okay or not. I saw them once or twice afterwards, but I mean, I think nobody should do what I did. You know, please don't ever do that. If you have friends, don't leave them behind.
Well, can I ask you something, though?
Yeah.
When you were competing, was that through high school? Was that earlier? Or?
Yeah, that was through high school.
It was?
Yeah.
So you had people in high school, but did you have any kind of network of people that you either competed with, against?
I mean, that's another problem in high school. By the time I was 16... high school meant nothing to me. It was just a place I had to go before I could train.
Okay.
It was a place where I went in the morning, cut first period, went to the gym, stretched out, did like 1,000 kicks, went to school for a little while, took lunch, went to the football field, did all my forms, took lunch, left at 2:50, got home, put my uniform on, went from the dojo to the dojo from about 3 o'clock to about 10:30 at night. That was every day. If I could just stay there, I would just stay there. And the school really was, I didn't want to go. I didn't have a choice. Luckily, because, you know, I had some very good teachers and very good people around me. I didn't like school. She realized now that it wasn't a school, Jeremy. I didn't like authority. It was hard for me to figure out psychologically why I never did good in high school, because when I went to college, I can never forget this. It was the first day of class. I didn't even know what class it was. And then teacher's like, listen, your homework is due on Friday. I'm like, I started laughing. I'm like, yeah, what if I don't do it? He goes, well, I don't give a fuck that don't do it. I'm like, excuse me?
That's a progressive teacher there. I like that.
I said, what do we mean? What if he goes, kid, I don't care if you do your homework. I don't care if you come to class. I don't care what the hell you do. This is your life. You're not a child. You're in college. Do whatever the hell you want to do and figure it out for yourself now. And I don't know what happened, man. That it just snapped something in me where I was like, wait a minute. Nobody's telling me what to do. Well, maybe I want to get A's. Maybe I want to study. And nobody believed it. I got a 4.0 the first semester. My parents were like, yeah, this is not your report card. Remember that time you forged your report card? I'm like, no, I didn't forge shit. I swear to God, this is my grades. Everybody was shocked, but I couldn't understand what the transition was. Now I understand. I don't like being told what to do. And that was a major problem in high school. And I just do about that. I didn't, like I said before, you know, I didn't keep up with my friends. And I'm sorry, guys, if you guys ever hear this podcast or you need to come across it. You guys were awesome. You were great, great, great friends. And I'm sorry that I wasn't around to see the rest of it. You know, I really wasn't after 1920. I was never around, actually. Spent all my time trying to figure myself out. I went through my own shit. You know, for those of you guys who don't know, and if you are listening, my friends, my high school friends, I became a handicapped very early in life. I was about 21 years old when I first tore my labrum. Had a bad surgery. My arm was locked in place for like 2.5 years. Couldn't do anything. Constantly suicidal. Didn't want to live. You know, I was a fighter and a lifter. I mean, that's all I did. My whole life was that. And now I didn't know what the hell to do in my life. I can't lift. I can't fight. What am I supposed to do? Thank God for my wife got me into computer graphics. And I became very involved in that. And Adobe Photoshop. And I was working on pictures for like 12 hours at a time. Started a website for Wolverine. That became really big and famous. It actually was so good that it would lose bandwidth. Every day would get shut down too much bandwidth. Because X-Men 2 would come out and everybody, and I had all these exclusive pictures from X-Men 2. And I'd take the camera to the theater and take pictures and shit. I was really intensely into it. But nobody knows, you know, this is part of my life. I went through all this shit and so much stuff between getting a BA in master's in finance and not liking a job, not wanting a job, wanting a job in management, not finding a job, going back to do my master's and then working in cell phone stores back and forth. And half the time, my parents didn't even know I was working. They thought I was just in school, but it wanted some pocket money, so I was trying to do whatever I could and managing things. Seeing my wife every day, going back and forth, sometimes driving back and forth to Jersey when she moved, back and forth to Queens, like constantly trying to get my shit together because I felt like I was 25, 26 years old. Everybody else had their career, man. They were like on their way. And I spent half my time at Bev's or with my wife or like trying to figure out what to do with my life. I felt like a bum, actually, to be honest with you. Because I didn't have a career at this point, you know? And luckily, after I got married, you know, thank God, my wife's sister's boyfriend gave me a job. I won't even name him because he's filthy, filthy, filthy rich. At that point, he wasn't as filthy as rich, but he bought a really shitty building in the South Bronx. And he said, "Do you want to manage it?" And I was like, "Yeah." He's like, "You're not afraid of anything, right?" I'm like, "No, you know, I'm not afraid of anything." And I swear to God, Jeremy, I went to job on the first day to the building, dressed up, dress pants, dress shirt. I get to the front door of the building, the stoop. I climb 2 steps. I hear, "Meow." Put your hands behind your head. I'm like, "What the fuck?" I'm like, "What do you do?" He's like, "Officer, no, don't turn around. Just put your hands behind your head." They come up to me. I'm like, "Can I help you, officer?" Like, "What the hell are you doing here?" I'm like, "I'm the manager." Like, they start laughing. "There's no manager for this place. Get the fuck out of here. What you selling? What you got on you?" I'm like, "Oh, nothing. I swear to God, I work for this company." Like, "Sure, okay." They didn't believe me. They took me to the precinct. And there I met Sergeant Rodriguez. He was in charge of the whole precinct. And he's like, "Listen, what are you doing here?" I said, "Listen, I work for the guy who owns that place." He's like, "Nobody owns that place. There's a bunch of Jews own that place." I'm like, "No, the Jewish Hasidic guys don't own it anymore." He's like, "You mean they got rid of the property? Some moron bought that place? And you're going to be the manager?" I'm like, "Hey." He's like, "Okay." As I was leaving, man, I kind of glad I didn't do it, but he was listening to me. "I don't know if you're comfortable with you going there without a gun. I just don't. So I'm going to write you a permit out. I'm going to get you a revolver. Keep it with you at all times." He's like, "You're going to get killed, white kid." And I really didn't fear anything, which is not a good thing. Guys, it's not good to not fear anything. It's bad. Fear teaches you where you should be careful and not be careful. It's a good sign. So it's stupid when you're not afraid of anything.
Right.
And, you know, they're checking me out every day. All the drug dealers coming down, looking at me left and right, this and that. Finally, after 2 weeks, one of them comes down, lights a doobie in front of me. I'm like, "What's up, man?" And I looked at him and said, "Listen, do you understand? I really don't give a fuck what you do. I'm not here for you. Like, I'm here to collect the rent for the building. That's it." And they're like, "Oh, you're not a narc?" I'm like, "Well, no, I'm not a narc. Are you kidding me? I don't even know what you're talking about." But the things that I saw there, Jeremy, stabbings, shootings. So that guy shot right in front of me, right in the head. Like, I used to go home, like, so damaged from what I saw. Like, what the hell? Like, I remember we were on the stoop, and all I hear is, "Get down, get down." My stoop jumps on top of me. And I was like, "What happened?" Pop, pop. I'm like, "What the fuck?" And again, never forget the guy who walking around right in front of the building in the purple purple polo and black shorts. Somebody walked right up to me, just shot him right in the head and just drove away. So it was just a really bad neighborhood. But it desensitized me, too, because right before I left to get a nice corporate job for the first time, that place and the other place he owned gave me so much experience. I built, at that point, I was building apartments. Building apartments, renovating brownstones, I mean, working with architects, you name it. I mean, everything I knew how to do. I could build something on my own if I had to at that point. So that's where I got a good corporate job. But before I left Jeremy, never forget this, I was in the lobby of that building. It's always filthy. We were trying to sell it at this point. And this guy runs out of the elevator holding his stomach, bleeding everywhere. Then the other guy stabbed him. And he runs out and he's running away. And my reaction, I'm still so ashamed of myself. I ran after him. I said, "You listen." I was like, come back. He's holding his stomach. I put a broom in his hand, a mop. I'm like, go clean that shit up. This ain't my job. He's here to clean your blood up. I was like, you made a mess. You clean that. He's looking at me like I'm dying. I'm like, I don't give a fuck. Go clean the blood up.
Yeah, that
and,
guy.
And then my Superman, he's like, Jefe, que pasa? I'm like, what? He's like, what's wrong with you? I'm like, I gotta get out of here, man. Like, I'm too desensitized to all this shit. And I didn't know it was the headquarters for the Bloods. I didn't even know what the Bloods were. I didn't even know what a gang it was.
What's a Crip? What's a Blood?
Yeah, I didn't know any of that until I learned the hard way there. So, but that's just, you know, if you guys are wondering why I never reached out to you after high school, it wasn't easy for me either, man. It wasn't like all daisies and shit. And it wasn't like, you know, a lot of people that I talked to afterwards, 20 years afterwards, Jeremy, they thought I must be a fight choreographer for somebody in Hollywood. This I got in that. I must own like 5 martial arts studios of my own. I must be an actor somewhere in Bollywood. Right. Like, this is the 3 things everybody that I talked to afterwards assumed I was doing. I'm like, I'm a property manager. Like, what? Why? Why? Like, but you were so talented. I'm like, well, nobody else thought. So thanks for letting me know now. A little too late, a little old. But I had no idea that, sometimes people see more of you than you see of yourself, especially when you're young, because nobody's there to tell you, really.
Right.
I didn't know. I had no clue, man. So, but you were a nice kid in high school, right? You weren't like rowdy. Like, I was just very rebellious in general.
See, I was also rebellious, just not the way you are. So you and I have very similar. If people were looking at it from a distance, the existential crisis at a certain point, the not really applying ourselves in school, there were a lot of things that we were doing or not doing the same way. So I was a terrible student in high school. I mean,
You're so smart.
Humiliated my family, a family of high achievers, and I graduated in the bottom quarter of my high school class. I almost got thrown out of school in 11th grade, not for drugs, not for being rebellious, not for setting bombs in a lunchroom or cherry bombs, or not real bombs, obviously.
Yeah.
But I just didn't care. And I was absent 60 days in 10th grade.
Well, that's me. That's
60.
That's me in 8th grade, man. I didn't
How did I graduate?
I don't know. I didn't go to 8th grade either.
I don't understand how I graduated on time. I guess I had been accelerated. Whatever. Somehow I graduated high school. But I was failing a lot of different classes. I don't even understand. I failed 3 science classes in a row. I failed 2 math classes in a row. I failed a Spanish class. Like, I don't have any idea how I graduated, but I did. But I had to, you know, what I talked about in our the previous podcast discussing our personal lives.
And right.
The things that went wrong and some of the things that went right and then went wrong again. And I just didn't care. I didn't care. And I just, everything was a shoulder shrug.
Whatever.
That was my attitude.
Mm.
But I had the loser mentality, not just having difficulty forming friendships or, heaven forbid, chatting with a girl, asking, hey, maybe we could get together or whatever the phrase might have been in 1991, 92 era. But I had the loser mentality, the expectation of failure. And it applied to every aspect of my life. Talked about how, well, that girl
sucks.
Won't like me back.
That sucks.
But I actually reached a point where, now if somebody said, well, Jared, you realize you're intelligent, right? Your IQ is near superior.
Yeah.
Okay. No, it is. It is. So? Well, when you sit there and say that you can't pass this class, you can. You're talking yourself out of doing a little work, yep. a little elbow grease yep. to pass. But I didn't accept that. Again, I had this idea in my head. If something didn't come easy, it wasn't worth even trying. Like, literally the opposite of what you're supposed to.
The opposite.
Like, I mean, I was so cockeyed as a kid. And again, if somebody met me 17 or 18 and would go back through the space-time continuum, you know what? He's entertaining. There's no way he believes what he's saying. Yeah, I did.
Wow.
So I somehow graduated high school. And when I started college in the fall of 1992. I had to start at Nassau. Now, I had gotten enough of my head together where I did see an academic future for myself, but I had to start small. And I can't blame my dad who paid for everything. Mm-hmm. No student loans here. That's I'm part of the first generation where big loans were at least starting to become in play. Yeah. That's a whole other podcast, maybe down the road. But I was okay with starting there. Let's see what happens, Jer. And if you do okay, you know, you'll get your 2 year and then we'll see what you want to do for it. So very, very positive, boosting you up. You can do this. So my first semester at Nassau Community was brutal. Now I'm going to tell you like a Stone Age kind of story here. I was so backwards. I didn't have my driver's license yet. Did not have a driver's license as I turned 18. I was still in high school, December 73. I turned 18 in 91. I didn't even take driving classes until the summer of 92. Wow. So my first semester at Nassau Community, I didn't have a driver's license. I was living in Woodbury at what's now called Eagle Rock, across the street at Jericho Turnpike from the gym, the Equinox gym. It used to be a movie theater, as we know. Yeah. And I had to, I'm going to tell you my version of I had to walk naked backwards in 3 feet of snow to get to the bus. No. But I did have a half-hour walk to get to the N79 bus, which took me close enough to Nassau Community to walk. That's a true story. And I walked right through the Cablevision Industrial Park from Eagle Rock, past what was the movie theater at the time, all the way down to the bus. So I was making an effort. I didn't do great the first semester. I managed to pass a math class. So I was starting to get the right idea that, okay, if you do a little bit of work, but I still had the loser mentality. In my second semester at Nassau, I took a science class, which was the same type of class that I had kept failing. So I went into this class thinking, I'm going to fail. I can't do this. And I remember I set myself up to fail because I did no work, did not study. And I ended up getting a 63 on the first test. I should have gotten a 20, okay? When I got the 63, the light bulb went off. And I got angry. Usually I just got angry at myself. But in this case, I was angry at myself for the right reason. I said, people have been telling you your whole life that you're smarter than almost anyone you're ever going to meet. Why don't you start acting like it?
It's true.
Why don't you stop expecting to fail and know that you can do better? So the switch, the light bulb went off. I began doing work.
Yeah.
It was still so much easier for me. So I ended up starting to get B pluses, A minuses, and mostly A's. And I graduated with a 3.91 from Nassau. Now that's really not like, that's okay. But it showed that if I applied myself, hey, I could actually get that. Like there was no excuse for me failing anything. Because I go back to high school. And I had the capacity to pass a chemistry class. This was not AP. This was good old-fashioned chemistry. Wow. I just refused to do any work. Physics. There was no reason why 16, 17-year-old me was flunking. But see, I didn't just flunk. I flunked with an 18 average. I flunked with a, you know, where the joke was that if you get a paperback and, well, what'd you get on it? I got a 10. Yeah, you got 10 wrong. You know, so I said that was one of my favorites. Yeah, he said he got a 10. He actually got 10 wrong. That's what the 10 meant. But I did well enough at Nassau where I got into NYU. And that's when my mindset had completely shifted.
That's awesome.
From I suck, I can't, to no, I will. I can handle this. It just, you know, something clicked. You know, like in your case, It was somebody saying that they didn't care, yeah. and it lit a fire under you.
Yep. It just changed. You know what? Even before that, though, it's really funny. I don't know. Like you, I didn't go to school at all for some time. Like in eighth grade, I was never even there. I literally didn't know I wasn't there. I just never came, never went. Something happened. Taekwondo changed me so much as a human being. I don't know, maybe because I started teaching at the age of 16. I'm teaching children and stuff. I just became a lot smarter, like, overnight. Remember I went to class senior year, and it was remedial math 3, right? You know, it's a remedial class. It's easy. And I started, like, looking at the board and to a teacher. I'm like, is this too easy? Like, uh-huh, yeah, show me. I did it. Like, no, I'm serious. Like, it's too easy. And she gave me, like, a harder question, a harder question, a harder question. Like, it's all right. And she's like, what the hell? I'm like, can I try regular math? She's like, you want to? So, okay, how about this? It was like October. He's like, I'll give you the math regions number 1 next week. See how you do. Okay, no problem. So I took the regions 1 and I got 100. And she was like, okay. And then she gave me part 2, I got 100. So in 1 year, one school year, I did 3 math classes. And I got 100 in all of them. Which is so weird because I couldn't understand math before that. But it's just the way it works. But besides this, I was going to ask you a really quick question about school.
Yeah.
Was there anybody, college or high school, that like you're thankful you had that made a difference?
Not high school. There really was nobody that was favorable. There were teachers who were nice, but see, I'm right in the middle. I'm, as I said last time, I'm 5 years older than Kenny. I'm going to be 50 at the end of December. I'm right in the middle of Generation X, and Generation X, as much as, you know, they, from a broad sense, are noted for achievement, noted for being very snarky and not taking anything seriously. And you think about 90s movies, Dazed and Confused, but films where you have characters who just didn't give a fuck or came across like they didn't. So I'm supposed to be that, because that was how it looked as I went through high school, that kind of ugly American or American wise-ass, the kind of character William Holden, to use an old name, used to play in movies, where he just always had an attitude, whether it was Stalag 17, Bridges of Tokari, Guns of Navarone. He had a type. And I was the sort of kid who was supposed to, or if I had gone on that path, just not give a shit about anything. Just
really
skating through. But when I was at New York University, 94 to 97, I had an overwhelmingly favorable experience. The professors were great. They always made time for us. And I had a number of professors where I would just sit in office hours with them and we would just bullshit about movies.
That's awesome. That's I thought you won. I had that. I only had that in my last semester. Okay, no. I should have said this. My first semester in college. I'm stupid, man. I'm a big believer in love. Like, love. Like, and I fell in love with somebody who I shouldn't have. And it was just a bad idea from the start. But I was really in love with her. Anyway, she left, broke my heart, just fucking destroyed me. And I missed my Spanish final. I just didn't even take it. And my teacher was so nice, man. I told her what happened. She let me come to her house and take it. And there were a lot of times the teachers in college, like you said, that you didn't just talk to them like normal people.
Right.
But I really got that when I was doing nursing the second time around at age 38. I had a chemistry teacher, and I suck at chemistry. I'm bad. So the first day, I tried doing my best. I didn't understand anything. I said, sir, I don't understand anything you wrote down. He goes, okay. I'm like, what do you mean, okay? He goes, it's okay. You're going to fail. I'm like, what? He's like, you don't understand. You failed. It's simple. Okay, goodbye. I'm like, what the fuck? I'm like, this guy's not going to help me. I asked him again. He goes, you look at me like, what do you want me to fucking do? So luckily, people are nice. And as soon as I acclimated myself to school, and by acclimated, I started cursing the way I curse now, because I didn't back then, and had totally different vocabulary because working in corporate. As soon as I became a teenager, everybody wanted to help me, and they were very nice, and thank God for that. But I went from my first test, I got a 10, And the next test, I got 98. So he went and meet me in the office. I think he was going to accuse me of cheating or something, but he sat me down. He looked at me in the mirror. He goes, "Who are you?" I'm like, "Eh? No, no, really. Like, who are you? Like, what do you mean?" He's like, "You are not ordinary student. Ordinary student does not go from 10 to 89. It is not possible. I want to know more about you." I'm like, "All right, you can Google me, man." And Google it indeed. I gave my resume, and he's looking at it. He goes, "Yes, yes. This makes sense. So much achievement in such short time of life. Yes, it makes sense. You are a doer. You are a doer. Okay, I understand now. Would you like a drink?" I'm like, "Huh?" It's fucking post vodka out of his
Crown
hand.
Royal, yeah.
Yeah, so we sat there drinking for a little while and talked about life, and he got into politics, and he was like, it was before Trump won, and he was so pro-Trump. He was like, he was so scared of Hillary winning. He was like, "I escaped communism. I don't want communism here again. This cannot win. Trump must be victorious." I'm like, "Okay, man. I got you, man. All right, calm down." But besides him, man, in my life, I mean, thank you for my friends in high school. Like I said, they helped me get through a lot of bad times. I mean, this is one time I'm talking about this. I can't believe I'm talking about this shit on the podcast. What's wrong with me? There was a time in high school, a lot of shit happened in a week. It was about a girl, it was about a dog, a whole bunch of shit. And I don't know. I was a very depressed teenager. And I decided I just wanted to end it all, you know? So I bought a bottle of vodka. No, they didn't stop at the liquor store. And I just started drinking my brains out. I figured I'd die alcohol poisoning. Just drink the whole bottle, you know? And I was passed out on the school lawn. Nobody did anything. And my friends found me. Rokes found me, Jeff and all of them. They were like, "Isaac, like, what the hell?" So they were like, "Just keep him awake, just keep him awake." And what they did was took me back to their house, emptied the bottle of vodka and filled it with water. And I was so fucked up, I just wanted to die. They're like, "Yeah, go ahead, die. Here, have some more. Drink some more. And they kept drinking, they kept feeding me more and more. I must have drank like 6 or 7 bottles of water at that point.
Wow, it would have helped you.
Yeah. And then I just kept drinking it and not understanding what's happening. The only thing I remember is Isaac, by the way, he was like, "Now's our chance. Smack him around if you want. He can't do anything." And I was like, "I can't stay." He's like, "No, you can't." He's like, "This is the only time I'm going to beat you up. I can't take you otherwise." And then I became a little sober, and they brought me back to school. In the meantime, my poor parents went through hell. They called my parents, "We don't know where your son is. He's suicidal. He might be dead. We're not really sure." We're like, "Well, excuse me? You're supposed to be in school." Like, "Well, we don't know where he is. We think he died." But my parents are scared shitless. Here I am coming to school, walking to school now with my friends. And another one of my friends, God rest her soul, Fada, she was like my sister. She comes running. She's like, "Oh, my God. Oh, my God, your mom and dad are here." I'm like, "Oh, my God." She's like, automatically, it's funny. Like, I still remember it looks silly, but there's like three girls come running, like all three girls I know. All three girls spray different perfumes on me. I'm like, "I don't think that's going to work. Like, maybe he'll do something. He'll do something." And I saw my mom and dad. They were already upset, but I started crying right away because I was just so upset over the whole thing that happened. They didn't bother me much. They took me, I had to go to a psychiatrist to get cleared for school and stuff. But it wasn't my friends. I might be dead, man. You know, they saved my life. And the second time around, actually, my wife saved my life. I don't know if she was what I'd do without her. I know we're divorced now, but she was a true gift. There for me every day through thick and thin. When I couldn't tie my shoes, she'd tie my shoes. When I, you know, couldn't take a shower, she'd take care of me. When I had my surgery, she was there the entire time. Like, you know, she did a lot more than she had to. And that's why she won over a very cold, stubborn human being in 2 years who didn't. I had no respect for women. And someone said I had no respect for women now. I don't know.
And Heath maybe thought I was joking last week. But yeah, no, Kenny's a very, very nice person. Now, that doesn't mean that, look, we all have ideas that if we shared all of them with everyone 100% of the time, you're like, "Throw a net on this person."
Exactly.
But we can, and this is why this is very important, the way that I look at things, it really comes down to how you treat people. And
that's right.
This guy treats people with kindness, with compassion, with understanding. And that is how I have, since I got over myself as a much younger person, this is how I've always aspired to be, without anybody putting a name to it, because I wasn't thinking in those exact terms.
Right.
I did want to say also that the story that he just told is crazy. So we, as we mentioned, we've known each other 25 years total.
Yeah.
Like, not to be negative, but when 9/11 happened, like, we were commiserating at the gym as well. And that's 22 plus years ago. So we had already known each other. So we go back a ways, and we have had a lot of, not similar events, but parts of our life where we maybe had a similar mindset, whether it was negative, whether we had very, very bad thoughts about our own selves. And but I was self-destructive, but not in the way that he was. I may have had the same kind of conceptual level of this is awful, but how I chose to go about it. So as I mentioned last week, I had extreme difficulty developing any kind of a social existence. I had some friends, but I was depressed all the time because I really wanted to get up close and personal with this girl in this grade and that girl in that grade. And like, again, that's very, very normal stuff.
Yep.
But to be specific, when I was a senior in high school, I started my senior year. I was sick, about 6'1", 215. I was chubby.
Really? I saw a picture. I was surprised.
Yeah, I was very kind of round faced. There's a picture of myself and my sister. I've never posted it. Our dad took us to the USS Intrepid in the city. Again, in movies, it's famous for where Will Smith is hitting golf balls in I Am Legend. So that's where we were. And man, my face is so round. And if you look, say, hey, come on, you're adorable. Well, I didn't feel adorable.
Yeah.
And my life was bad. So I kind of got religion, figuratively speaking, at the beginning of my senior year in high school, where I was very chubby, overweight, miserable 100% of the time. And I just out of nowhere developed a crush on this one particular young lady. And that was enough to convince me to stop eating potato chips and dip and then having a full dinner, to kind of start to take diet. And when I say diet, I don't mean dieting. I mean just what I was putting in a daily basis. Like, I'm the kind of person, like, all or nothing. Kenny is similar. You either go hard or go home.
Yep.
Without putting it that way, I never would have said that when I was younger, but that's what it was.
Yep.
So I had this crush, and I calculated stupidly, well, maybe if I get abs, I have a shot. Okay.
We've all done that.
But you still have to be able to literally communicate. So
that's not what you think of that age.
No, right. I started to lose weight. I started to become more active. Again, you're 17, 18, don't have, let's say, a sluggish thyroid or some kind of real medical issue, which we know does happen to people. I lost weight very quickly, but I still could not communicate with this girl who I had such a crazy crush on. And I'm already 17, 18. I'm not 9. I'm not a cute little 10-year-old. I'm at a level where I could smoke, you know? I might be able to get a drink in certain states or drive a tractor, whatever. So I had a point, without going into a very long, drawn-out story, I kept putting myself into situations where I could interact with this young lady.
Smart.
And I could not overcome how scared I was. And this was, I talked about social anxiety disorder. You know, this was specifically, I was supposed to be having a normal, frightened, nervous reaction as everybody experiences, whether you're 18, whether you're 40. Nobody likes getting shot down.
Nope.
And you're never certain whether someone's going to say yes.
Oh, you have no idea.
Right.
You have no idea.
But I had a terrible moment. It was in March of 1992. It was a long time ago. It was 31 and a half years. But I had this moment. It was a school event. I went and she was there. And when I left this school event at Massapequa High School, I didn't have a driver's license, even though I was 18. So I had walked there. It was about a mile from the house where I grew up. And I walked back to near home. And rather than go home, I made a left turn to, there was a canal that goes to Great South Bay. Basically, okay. If you know the layout of Massapequa, this is the kind of the Biltmore Shores, Massapequa Shores area.
Okay.
And I did not know what I was going to do, but I wanted to throw myself into the water.
Oh, God.
Now, I know how to swim. The water was not that deep, and there weren't any currents. So I immediately, as soon as I was like, oh, throw myself, and I'm crying, all I was going to do was get myself wet. But in Kenny's terrible story that he told before, when he reached what he thought was his end,
yeah,
he grabbed a bottle of liquor and tried to hurt himself in that way. And he was fortunate enough to have friends.
Got lucky.
In this particular instance with me, it was realizing how stupid I was being and that, no, I was not going to be able to talk to this girl. But throwing myself into the water just so I can climb myself out.
At least you realized.
I'm just going to get wet. And if anybody sees it, I mean, you're the biggest knucklehead in history here.
You know, you reminded me of two things. You said that there's always somebody you meet that makes you think you should have abs. So I think I told the story before, but I'll tell it in more detail. Eighth grade was the first time that I had a crush on anybody. Her name was Denise Mediatis. I remember her name. She's very cute. I thought she was a very pretty girl. She was actually very nice to me. Italian, dark black hair, pretty. And it wasn't lust. I really actually had a real crush on her. Like, I really, like, I mean, she smiled. I, like, melted. So I wrote her, like, a whole letter and everything. Well, of course, she showed the whole school the letter. And everybody was laughing their asses off at me. I'm like, oh, my God. It was so fucking embarrassing, Jeremy. Like, I was everywhere you went, everybody was staring at me laughing. I'm like, oh, my fucking God. Somebody kill me. Kill me, kill me, kill me, kill me, kill me. And the joke went on for a little bit. You know, I just, what else could I do but ignore it? But I never forget this kid, older kid, Lewis. He said he was horrible. He was a really bad kid. I mean, bad. Beat the shit out of people. Like, just a bad seed. But really good looking, like, Romeo type, tough guy, like, kid, pocket knife carrying, older dude. And, yeah, and he comes up to me. He goes, come here. Okay, he's like, you listen to me. He pats my stuff. He goes, you fucking lose this. You have whatever you want. You understand me? There's nothing wrong with you. Because he felt bad they were making fun of me. He's like, nothing wrong with you. She'd want you too. He's like, lose the Hawaiian shirt and lose the goddamn belly. I'm like, okay. And, you know, it was very nice. I mean, and the way I think about it now, he was trying to be nice to me.
Right.
I was like, oh, no fat. But I guess I was fat. But that in my head, yeah, sure. There were times when I was in the dojo and I'm like, see, now girls like me. But the funny part was, Jeremy, that it went so overnight bananas over the top from, like, not being liked to having girls all over me that I... But unfortunately, anybody who I liked, I got the same thing. You're too nice, like a million times from people.
Right. And that can happen. And I certainly, I'm embarrassed to admit, when I was in college, when I was struggling, I don't want to say I got friend zoned. I allowed myself to be that kind of person. And look, I needed it for growth. And the thing is, what I've found, and this is why... maybe this would be another podcast. But my thinking has evolved as I've gotten older, has shifted and changed. And what I found is that life has given me different chances. I've had other opportunities to reach a sense of catharsis. And so, like, literally, my 20-year high school reunion, I got to meet and chat, take a picture with, and really talk to the girl that I had the crush on in high school.
What was that like?
It was great.
That's so
cool. It was great because I went from this shaky, helpless 18-year-old kid who not only couldn't get out of his own way, but was, you know, we talk about people running from a fight. I wasn't running from a fight. I was running from a, hey, how are you doing? That's what I was running from. And, to be able to have a real adult conversation with this person. You know, we're both in our late 30s at the time.
Yeah, that's nice, though.
It was fantastic. It was, to me, the highlight of my 20-year reunion. Was because, I'm not stupid. I knew that back in high school, she was a real person. I knew that there was nothing out of the ordinary. My feelings weren't inappropriate or bizarre, or it was normal stuff. It was my reactions and my behavior that were wrong. So being able to actually make a connection, and you know, somebody that I would now even I haven't seen her, but someone I would consider a friend, because we had, from completely different poles, we had an experience. Because she was waiting, probably, why won't this guy talk to me? Just talk. Not, I don't mean like that. And me just trying to get there and not being able to get there. But we all mature in different ways and mature differently at different times. And life doesn't always, or doesn't even often, give us those kinds of moments.
Yep.
But when we can have them, grab them. Because maybe in your case, some of the people that were left behind, or some of the people that, see, this is obviously social media has its negatives, and the interconnectedness of the world has everybody on edge, and everything is heightened because information travels so quickly.
Yep.
But the positive thing is, it's now more likely that we can right perceived wrongs, if in fact we want to.
I've done that before, but I don't think they were wanting to really reach out much, so I didn't force it too much. You know, I'll tell you one, before we go, one funny story, because you remind me of, you never go talk to this girl, reminding me of my wife. So when I was second semester of college, I remember seeing this girl walk around and in the parking lot, like, wow, that girl's hot. Wow. Like, she's stunning. And I was always with some girl or another. And they want my attention, so I couldn't give too much attention. I had a, I don't know what it was, philosophy, some class I had, right? And my wife had the class in the same room before me. So I would go there every day and stand there, you know, that at the host of me saying hi to her, you know, when she came out. And, man, Jeremy, I know how you feel. I just, the words wouldn't come out. I'm like, okay, bye, tomorrow. And there were some times where I'd said a hello and she just walked past me. Excuse me, walked past me. Hello, walked past me. I swear to God, I'm not exaggerating, dude. One day, I said, fuck this. I let's lie down. I just laid down. She fucking walked over me. That's when I gave up. I'm like, yo, I just laid down. The girl walked over me. It's done. There's nothing else you could fucking do. Just forget it. So there was some other girl in class and I started dating her. I'm like, whatever, who cares? 4 months later, I'm dating somebody else. I was always dating somebody. And we're in the car, me and this girl. I'm like, oh, you know that girl? She goes, yeah, I know her. Yeah. I'm like, yeah, she's like, yeah, total bitch. I'm like, really? She's like, yeah, you think she's too good for the world? She's like, I know her from high school. You wouldn't want to date her. She's useless. You know, I'm like, yeah, come over here. Come next to me. I'm like, oh, you sure? Like, no, don't even think about it. She just really convinced me that my wife was just an asshole, doesn't want to talk to anybody, stuck up and all this other shit, and, you know, way out of my league, and I should just make out with her. Fast forward, like, another semester. We went to this, finally, like, for the first time, they started this international club, right? So, like, we called it the international. It was more like a bunch of Indian kids hanging out. And that's where I made a lot of my friends I still have now. Abe, you know, I still talk to Abe. He's still, that's where I met him there, and a few other people. And we're sitting there, man, and waiting for meeting to start. And we were just, this is when I first joined Bev's. All right, so I was like,
all what year?
98.
Oh, so it was, so we met not long after. So I joined in March of 1993. I was still a teenager.
Yeah, so.
And I go back far enough where Bev was actually working the desk.
Oh, my God.
In the afternoons. And Steve, if he's out there, I doubt he is. But, you know, Steve used to have a kind of bushy hair. And, you know, he's significantly older than me. But he was really young 30 years ago. If you think about, we think of him now with the shaved head and this
first,
and that.
First thing I saw when I walked in was Frank Seppi and him walking around.
Right.
And I was like, holy shit,
what are these things? Met Frank in 96. Yeah. He's an awesome guy. Back a ways.
Another awesome person.
Yeah.
So anyway, so go back. You know, I'm very health conscious at this point, and so is the other guy sitting there, and like the president of the club is this little chubby dude, and he brought samosas. Those guys don't know samosas. They're samosas, like Indian fried food. It's made of potato, basically. And he picks it up. We're like, oh, what you doing, man? He's like, you need samosa? Like, really? Should you really? I have to think about that, man. I mean, come on. Like, take a look. He's like, whoa. We're like, don't you want to get laid, bro? Like, come on now. He's like, we were making fun of him, and he's quite waiting for the vice president to walk in. This cute girl walks in, all chirpy and stuff. She's a lot of fun. I'm like, oh, we're taking a vote, nomination, making the vice president the president. You're out, boy. He's like, what? We're like, fat boy, you're done. Peace out. We just know, son. You can't do that. We're like, we just did. And like, it was like 10 of us just all, we just made a motion. And he's like, I'm the president. We're like, but there's 10 of us. It's one of you. So we vote her for president. He was so pissed. And I became friends with that girl. She was very cool, a lot of fun to hang out with. I liked her. Like, she was very, very cute. A lot of fun in general, right? But one of my other friends I met at that time, I guess he liked her too. He's one who took me to Bev's. So we're working out one day, and we're doing a decline bench. I'm like, listen, you like her? He's like, yeah. I'm like, you like her. If she likes you, then what the fuck am I doing? I don't need to be in the middle of this. I can find somebody else. So I talked to her the next day. I said, listen, it's all good. You guys be happy. I don't really care. I'll find somebody. Don't worry about it. She said, but wait, I know somebody who likes you. I'm like, listen, I don't need your pity. It's all good. Thank you very much. She said, no, my sister. I'm like, I don't want to know your sister. I don't. That is too weird. I don't want to know your sister at all. And she just wait. She's on her way. I'm like, okay, fine. So we're standing like at the end of the door entrance of Pell Hall and Post. And like down the hall, like I see this girl coming. And she's like, there she is. I'm like, where? She's like, there. I'm like, where? Right there. I'm like, no. The only girl I see coming is that model chick that won't talk to me. She's like, yeah, that girl. I'm like, the girl with the black hair. She's like, yeah. I'm like, the girl wearing all black. Yeah. That girl. She's like, yeah. That girl right there. She's like, the one who's really, really hot. She's like, excuse me? I'm like, that girl, she got like 10 feet away, Jeremy. I'm like, this girl's your sister? She's like, I'm like, oh my God, who's adopted? She's like, what? I'm like, is one of you adopted? She's like, no. I'm like, blood sister? She's like, I'm like, you sure? She's like, what does that mean? Like, I'm just asking. And I feel like how mean it sounds. I'm like, I was like, one of them's got to be adopted, for God's sakes. And that's when she introduced me to my wife. And, you know, we started talking. And I still didn't have the balls where to ask her, Jeremy. She ended up asking me out. But, and I've never, and, you know, for you, it's different. Like, you weren't, like, dating around people and stuff. I, at this point, had already been modeling for Ralph Lauren. I was already out there. I've been on a million dates. Dating women was not a big deal to me. It's just that my wife was, one, perfect looking, perfectly poised, well-spoken, super intelligent, got all A's. Like, you know, everything I wasn't, you know? Here I am, like, this, like, protein shake drinking punk fucking asshole guy who's in a bunch of gangs, you know? Like, we're, like, literally the opposite of each other. And luckily she didn't realize most of that for a while. I kept it mostly a secret, like, what I was, like, really into and what I was like. And she just liked that I was very nice. That was about it. And that's it. It's funny, you couldn't talk to her either. I couldn't talk to my wife either, but ended up okay, and then ended up at her house to go meet her, and her dad freaked out. Like, I came to the front door, and he's like, what the fuck is this? That was, like, wearing a wife beater, had three earrings, brown hair. He's like, no. No. But then, it's funny how, like, people, you can't judge a book by its cover.
Right.
You know? I speak all our languages, and very much into our culture, and they're very surprised about that. They were like, oh, he speaks Hindi? He does puja? Oh, I'm like, yeah, I do it all, dude. Whatever it takes.
Jack of all trades.
Yeah, whatever it takes, I want your daughter.
You know, you just reminded me. I watched a movie. It was okay. A film that just hit Amazon called A Million Miles Away. And it's with Michael Pena, terrific actor.
Oh, I like him.
And it's a true story of, I think the guy's name is, when he's still around, Jose Hernandez. And he was a NASA engineer who ended up going into space.
Wow.
But he meets a woman. She's selling him a car. And he calculates, I think she's single, and it all happens really fast. And so he asks her out, and she basically says, and this is a cliche, you're going to have to meet my dad. But in their case, they're both the same culture, not Hindi, they're both Hispanic, and they live in the same area. And when he meets the father says words to the effect of, you could come around and visit with my daughter whenever you like, but I always have to be there. And he's like, okay, sir. And he's like looking around like, well, what am I supposed to do? But anyway, it wouldn't be a movie if it didn't end up working out. But hey, meeting the parents, doesn't matter who you are or what culture it is.
You know, I did it for my in-laws. My wife's uncle had died, right? And I remember I was at my boy's. He's like, yo, the uncle died, we gotta go. I'm like, all right, let's go. Again, I never had any clothes when I worked at a Bev's. I rarely wore wife beaters and never wore a shirt. I never wore any clothes. I just walked around naked all day. You'd ask Michelle, she was like, you're so fucking vain, wear a fucking shirt. And we had to go there, so I wore my boy's shirt. I grew up very raised right, I guess you could say. Like, you know, I cook, I clean, I do everything anyway. So when I went to the house, I felt bad. Like, nobody wanted to do anything. I started cooking food. I started, like, chopping up food. And I still remember, like, my wife's aunts were like, oh, yeah, that's the one.
Right, that's there. The keeper.
That's the, he's good looking.
We didn't have to say anything.
Nope.
We just, yeah.
He's tall. He's good looking. Speaks our languages. He cooks. Oh, that's the one, honey. And it's so funny that it used to always be that all my wife's aunts, man, they all love me. They used to always be like, you know, he's the one. You better keep this one. And sometimes I miss them, actually. Because, you know, once you get divorced, the whole family's gone, you know? And I miss my father-in-law sometimes. He's such a nice dude, bro. Such a nice dude. Like, fun, very intelligent human being, nice talk to. I miss my wife's aunts. They were fun. They were just a lot of fun to hang out with. They're rowdy, some of them. And, you know, that was a whole part of my life, too, because when you're married to somebody, you see their family all the time, too.
That's right. So now, I do, since you brought that up, I do have to tell this story.
That was doing.
So, Elsa, who I was married to.
Yeah.
We... As I said last time, it took a while for us to get going, but in the summer of 2011, we took a trip to Washington State, which is where her family is from, the very top of the state, Blaine, Washington. It's probably different now, but the cell service was a little wonky. It kept telling you, you've left the United States, and you're going to get hit with roaming charges. It thought we were in, like, near Vancouver. So anyway, we had a really, really amazing vacation because... The entire family at the time lived in Washington State. One of the sisters lived about 2 miles elsewhere in this town called Blaine. And the other sister lived in Seattle. And so I just really clicked with her parents.
That's awesome.
And towards the end of the vacation, they sat me down. And when I say sat me down, there were other people around, but they wanted me to say, there's something we really like to tell you, Jeremy. You know, we've had so much fun having you in in this house here, and we love New York, and you're a real New Yorker. And then they said, we just wanted you to know that you're always welcome here in our home.
That's nice.
And Elsa started to kind of say, you know, smile. And then for whatever reason, I'm not sure if it was Leo or Mary, but what they said next was, doesn't even have to be with Elsa. You're always welcome here. And she's like, what? What? What?
That's nice, man. I wish. And yeah, I don't know. Since I wonder, like, my daughter goes to her grandparents all the time, right? And she always tells me, oh, you know, grandpa misses you. I'm like, I don't know. I think it'd be really weird for them, too. Because remember, my ex is, you know, with somebody now. So,
right.
And they like him a lot, too. So I just don't want to mess anybody's life up more than anything else. It's not me. I'll be happy either way.
Right.
I don't want to fucking make his life up, you know? Like, if they're good together, they're happy together, why get in the middle of it and cause him to get all pissed off and shit, and then you fight with her and stuff? So I just try to leave it alone just for their own sake. And my daughter's happy. She gets to go both places. So.
But you know, and this is also from experience, amazing how many experiences I've had and things I've seen that a lot of people don't. I am the product of divorce.
Right.
And there was a lot of acrimony between my parents for a number of years, but then they got over it. They never got back together. They were never close to getting back together, but they really respected each other.
Yeah.
And I know this, and look, divorce is brutal. It can be horrendous. But just from the perspective of a kid of divorce, and you know, if my sister was here, she probably wouldn't explain this the same way. But knowing that our parents... No matter what they had been through, because they were together 20 years, married 17 plus, knowing that they had a deep respect for one another, I don't know, it made me feel, I know we're not supposed to take validation from that, or, well, I met, but knowing that they didn't hate each other's guts, that there was respect, that my mother would invite my father over when she was still in Pequot, Cook, when my dad got busted up in Florida when he had the osteoporotic meltdown where he messed up his back, he messed up his hip. My mother visited him in the hospital every day.
Yeah.
And so sometimes it's not feasible, but it is good to know that someone misses you.
Yeah.
Someone that you made a favorable impression on their life.
Yeah. We talk almost every day, man. So like it's, and I'll be honest with you, the first 2 years, oh my God, all I did was curse her out every day. You know, you cheated on me, you left me, you did this, blah, 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 blah. Like it was just a really, it was very, very nasty. And I think about it now, I was yelling at her all the time. She still paid for my parking. She still paid my phone bill. She never said a fucking thing. She knew it was her fault. You know, I'll be first to say this now, I can't believe I'm saying this. I haven't never really said it before. I blame myself a lot for this too. And I know it looks like it shouldn't be blamed because I didn't cheat. I didn't do anything wrong. That's not what just marriage is.
No.
You know,
and remember, I mentioned how, and you even asked me the question, how could I hold myself accountable, just from a broad sense.
Yeah.
But there are things that we do and don't do. We only get one shot. We usually only get one shot. And in my case, as I said, what seemed to be, well, this isn't really that important. So you didn't want to go to Hanu on a random Friday. Yeah, well, it wasn't just one. Sometimes it's a lot of different things. So if you want to, listen, even with my parents, if you look at it and say, well, his father really tried his hardest, he did that, but sometimes it's what the other person needs.
Yeah, for me, it was, I think financial instability is a big deal for women, not like men. Everybody's different, right? So, like, I could be dead broken. Yes, I'd be very worried about it, but I'll just go drive a cab and make it happen. Like, I'm the kind of person who just makes, I'll just keep working hard.
Tough it out. If you have to drive Uber, whatever it is, that's your personality.
That's my personality. She's just always worried about that kind of stuff. And we went through, you know, being homeless twice. That was one thing that was very hard for her. And two, you know, it's difficult when you're supposed to protect your wife from everything around you. And you can't really protect her from everybody and everything.
No.
Because certain social societies come in the way, like culture comes in the way, and family comes in the way, and you realize that you only did part of your job. I realize it now. There's so much more, because I'm a very different person now. I'm so different than I was back then. I think I didn't realize my priorities in life. I think I, you know, unfortunately, my culture screwed me up a lot. In our culture, the way we're brought up, the way we're brought up to think, it makes you very less independent. It forces you to let go of your individuality and to become kind of a puppet. You don't think about yourself first. You think about everybody else first, like a unit first, which is a very bad way to live a life, guys. You have to, if you are not happy with you, no matter how much you do for other people, you will in the end be the one who's not suffering. And they're going to look at you and be like, we didn't ask you to do anything. Who asked you to do this? But that is, unfortunately, if you grew up in the Eastern culture, it's part of our culture to sacrifice a lot sometimes. And what if your spouse doesn't want to sacrifice? What if they don't feel the same way? What if they don't feel the same way about anything? You know, right. You're not, just because you're happy doesn't mean they're happy with the same thing. So, you know, I've never apologized, but I like to apologize to her. It's not just her, and I understand she just wanted a way out at that point, because she went on midlife crisis, felt trapped also, never got to do things she wanted to do. My thing always is that we will do it when we have money. Like even now, okay, perfect example. I want to buy a more advanced sim racing. You know, the wheel that I have there, it's nice. I want to buy something else. I say to myself, when I have money, I'll buy it. She was at that point in life where she didn't want to wait for that next step to happen. Mm. I want it now.
Right.
And I think it's from not having anything when you're younger and not doing what you wanted to do when you're younger. So I understand her. And, you know, women in general, if you're listening to this, if you're a girl and if you're a guy, understand that women are not like men. And when they want certain things, they want them. And if you're a man, try to provide them the best you can.
And communication is key.
Yep.
It's a cliche, but it's so true. So if you, for example, whether Kenny's culture, now I know in my culture this is a cliche, and I know we're kind of pushing the limits as far as time, but we're really hitting a lot of very important stuff here.
Yeah, this is not
real life stuff.
And this is nothing what I want to talk about, by the way.
But it shows that when we chat, we go into different areas and we hit areas of our lives that sometimes are painful, but that we need to get them out.
I agree.
And I know that my father was brought up. He didn't really have much money. This is, again, a cliche, successful Jewish immigrant story that my father's father was so successful coming from literally nothing. But my dad, when he was asked, and I asked a question of one parent and then the other parent, independent of one another, when they were both in their 70s, this is probably 5, 6, 7 years ago. I said, Dad, when you were growing up, when you thought, if you imagined that you would ever be a husband and father, what's the most important thing as a husband and father? He looked at me like I asked him the dumbest question. I was already in my 40s.
Provide.
And he looked at me like, Jerry, are you fucking stupid? He said, good provider.
Yep.
So what kind of question is that? And he couldn't believe that I asked him that question. I asked my mother the same question. And she's like, Jay, husband, father, first. Good provider, that's fine. But now everyone's different. There are some people, and this is not to cast aspersions or make judgments, but in the case of my parents, that's a conversation they probably should have had.
Yeah.
Where my dad could have said, well, Candy, I'm trying to do this. I'm not doing that. I'm not just working, you know, to jerk myself off here. I'm doing this so that our kids will always have a roof over their head, clothes on their backs 50 years from now. My mom wanted to go on vacation more. She appreciated the stuff that he was able to do and work hard. But what you said about, I don't want to wait. This is what I would like to do now.
Yep,
right and now. That's so like all of those different vacations my father didn't go on, it wore my mother out. And that's a real thing.
Yeah, and that's so, this is, I don't know, I hope if you guys are married, listen to this if you're dating. Please, what we just said is so serious. You guys don't understand, you think it's no big deal right now. It'll add up, man. I mean, it adds up real quick. And then and women, men, we always say, we'll do it tomorrow. And we probably will. We might forget about it. Women, one, don't forget, ever. They'll always remember. And it eats them up inside.
Right.
It seems to do, like, a lot of emotional damage. They feel like they're missing out on something or they're not being taken care of.
They have to be heard.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's as simple as that. Because, like, there are moments in life we think something earth-shattering, either good or bad, has taken place. And a few years down the road, we realize it wasn't. And then there are little moments that are. And that's it. It's not always about the, you know, checkmate, the big chess move where you get to the finish line. Sometimes it's the little things, like the song, like the movie, the little things that get you caught. And sometimes it is as simple as hearing what your partner is saying, hearing what your parent is saying, and listening and trying rather than, well, I'll do it another time. You know, hey, we talked about there is no tomorrow, you know. And this is what it is, that sometimes something really small can sink you, or you rise to the surface. You may not see it coming until it's too late, or you get surprised on the long side, which is, wow, I'm really glad I did that.
Yep. Just guys, you know how it was small things that made you fall in love? You know, she got up and got you water. You got up and got her juice. You know, you bought her something that she liked to eat. The same way, those are the small things you stop doing that they start seeing, like, yeah, you don't care anymore. Like, you don't want to do them. And of course, we're going to say we can't right now. We're busy. I'm providing for you, this and that. Listen, guys, providing can never be an excuse. I understand you, as men, we work very hard. I get it. I understand that. But you got to find a balance.
Right. Sometimes you can't get away from it. That's absolutely true. Yep. But you have to be willing to make yourself uncomfortable sometimes.
I got
to
tell you, Jeremy, I lost that balance. Yeah, I never admit this.
It's normal. And I was so intractable. Oh, I'm going to wake up at 3. Blah, blah, blah.
Yep.
I had more control over that nonsense. You were in situations where you were busting your tail.
But you see how I am here? Guys, you guys don't know. You're watching this online. You have no idea. But he knows. I sit here at this desk for like 15 hours at a time.
And he's right. He's editing. He's finding graphics like with the Exorcist podcast. Yeah. I mean, I realize we're promoting the show here, but he did not simply cut things a particular way. He's working this.
So
this is for
everything I do when I decide to do it. If I want to be successful at it, like when I started real estate, I was working two jobs. I want this to go somewhere, guys. Hopefully one day somebody watches and be like, oh, he worked really hard for this. But it's not going to happen if I don't really work my ass off.
Right.
So, yes, I put in 14 hours a day every day for the last 3-4 weeks, and I'll continue to do it for another 2-3 months. But see, that's my point. I'm not married right now.
Right.
Okay? So it's fine. It's okay if I sit here 15 hours. I'm not married.
Nope.
I did the same thing when I was married. I would leave in the morning, come back at 6, pick up some food, leave, go show houses, come back at 11, go to the gym from 11 to 12, and come back home at night. When did I see my wife?
And be a zombie, be exhausted.
Yeah. And when did I see my wife? I didn't.
Yeah.
Why? Because we're already together for that point, 15 years. It's okay. You'll be all right. Doesn't matter. 15 years, 20 years, 30 years. It doesn't change. You got to make time for each other.
Yeah.
And I swear to myself, I work really hard, Jeremy, and I make good money, I'll have more time to spend with them, and that's not how it works.
No, you have to seize the moments as they happen. Yeah. And, we all have regrets. We all have either lost loves or just general regrets where I wish I had said this and I didn't, or I wish I hadn't done this and I did, or whatever it is. So all we can do, because life is a learning experience.
Yep.
All we can do is to try to take what we've done right, done wrong, and go from there. And we got into this last week also, where certain things that come up where you remember either you got something right or got something wrong, and then you can use that information to hopefully make a better decision. But what you're saying is the next time you are in a situation where it's someone you deeply care about, somebody that you see a future with, you will be able to make the decision, okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's...
What's priority at that point?
It's painful to even think of.
Yeah.
But so much of life is
difficult for people sometimes people like me and Jared, we're go-getters. It's different. We are regimented people who do the same thing every single day, who want... Like right now, all I'm thinking is when I'm finished talking to you guys, I gotta go to the gym. I didn't go yesterday, so I'm dying to go. And then I'll come back here and work until 3 in the morning. But I could not go and work and make my life easier, but I can't not go. And my shoulder's actually hurting. My labrum was hurting, but
shit,
still going to go anyway. But that's, everybody's different. And if you're that kind of person and you're in a relationship, your relationship could suffer. Yep. Unless she goes to the gym too. But then are you talking to her in the gym? Or are you like, yo, go do your workout, let me do my work.
Right, right.
So I hope what we've been through helps other people if they hear this. If you're a guy and you're thinking about being in a relationship, understand what that means. Yes. It's not, you're not just banging somebody and then you're out doing your own thing. It doesn't work that way.
No.
You're involved in their life. And if a girl's telling you they don't want you to be involved in their life, get a better girl, man. I'm sorry, we talked about this before. Actually, that's what we're going to talk about today. We're not going to, but a high quality woman wants you in her life for every aspect and wants your opinion. Will do what you might want to do, but still want your opinion on things and share things with you. A low quality woman just wants you around for sex and doesn't want you for anything else and thinks she's independent and doesn't need you. That's not the kind of person who's going to be a mom for your kid, by the way. If she thinks she doesn't need you, she doesn't want to be a parent, she doesn't want to be a mom, doesn't want to be a wife.
Right. And it is important when you realize that people are making you a priority. That's what he's talking about. And people do it in different ways. So, for example, if you are not sure about somebody, she's really attractive, but I think this might be for the wrong reason. If she's reaching out to you and there's nothing on the other end, there's no expectation of, can you take me to do this or do that, or let's go to some fancy place, you'll know.
You'll know.
And that's, again, there's so many cliches. The reason why they're cliches is that it's a universal experience for many people. You know when somebody is trying to make you a priority.
Yep. And a lot of women listen to this podcast as much as men do, but same thing goes for you ladies. Man, if you're dating somebody and he has no value for you, except just to hit it from behind and then like, oh, I gotta go. Please. There's enough guys out there who are caring, nice, will treat you right, take care of you.
Yeah.
And bang the hell out of you at the same time. But there's enough good men out there. You know, just look for them. Stop looking for the guys that look like freaking fuckboy douchebags. That's not going to help you at all. I mean, even as a guy, we were just talking about this. We're trying to not look for the girls that look like Instagram models. I don't want that. That always comes with the same shit. I'd rather have a girl that's kind of average looking, but is an amazing person.
Yes. Because let's face it, you're not having porn star sex that often relative to the rest of your existence of work and, you know, whatever other activities you might be doing at the gym, having a podcast.
And if you are, let's just say you are having sex 8 times a day, it's amazing. Then that's all you're doing. I've been in that world before too, and it kind of sucks. You think it sounds good, it does not. In the end, after about 4 weeks, you're like, you know, we don't talk at all. And she looks at you, she goes, do you want to talk? She's like, I kind of did. And then when she does, you realize she's an idiot, or you're an idiot. One you realize is...
Someone's an idiot in this situation.
Someone's got to get out of here. This has got to end right now, and then it's over. Because you never even spoke to each other. You know, believe me, I've been in this situation many times too, where you're like, what am I doing with this person? And it's just not good. You want to be with somebody that's... and guys, don't think love doesn't happen more than once. That's bullshit.
Yeah, that's
I've heard that before too. Will I ever love anyone like my ex-wife? I don't know. Maybe. But I have before. It wasn't just her. There's a few people that I've actually cared about so much that I would do anything for them. Even after her, there was somebody like that. And, you know, it just didn't work out for many circumstances, unfortunately. And it broke me. I mean, after I was put together again after 7 years, having to meet this person where things, and I was willing to change my entire life. I was willing to run to another country. Thank God my friend stopped me. But unfortunately, things didn't work out, and it ended the way it ended. But that, probably about 5 months of depression, it was really, really, really bad. That's because I really cared, though. So my whole point is, you guys think you're never going to feel that way again? You were wrong.
Yes.
You will. And you'll know when you do.
And just, you have to open yourself up. Anytime you make yourself vulnerable, there is a chance you're going to get hurt.
Yeah.
But that's just part of life. Life is not just sitting back having sex with a random stranger 8 times a day. It is about experiencing new things, going places, doing stuff. That's what it is.
True. It's, you know... It's funny Jeremy says that because I'm just thinking about, he said 8 times a day. So thinking about that sex.
That's the true part.
And sure, that's memorable, you know, like, yeah, it was fun, you know, a million things you've done, one person, two together. But that's not the memorable part.
No.
The memorable part would be where we went to eat afterwards and the funny thing that happened. So that's the funny part. Like, you would think, like, you know, all that awesome sexuality was fun. Yeah, it was fun, but... These are not the things you remember in life as you go older. When you're old, you're not going to, like, remember that girl. No. You're like, remember that movie that we saw together? And I said the other night during The Exorcist, if you guys saw my podcast, I shouted out my ex-girlfriend because we saw that movie together when she was in NYU. And
my alma mater.
Yeah, it was funny because she had never seen it before. And I don't think I'll let everybody watch the movie. So... So I was laughing at the podcast. I'm like, I don't think I even let her watch it. I think it just harassed her the entire movie. So it was just kind of funny. But, I mean, it brought back a lot of memories. And, again, it's not what happened with her. It's the memory of what happened and where we were. We were in Astoria. We ate afterwards, you know.
Right.
The whole thing, the whole kingdom blew together. So take it seriously, guys. And, you know, I know I dropped another toy. We've gone on long enough. And by the way, just so you know, I guess we'll try next podcast. What I wanted to talk about was toxic masculinity, toxic feminism, Andrew Tate, the Whatever podcast, a few other podcasts I hear, Fit and Finish and whatever it is, Fit and Fine, whatever.
Yeah, that's what you were mentioning
last time. That's what I wanted to talk about. And me and Jeremy did like a little pre-show thing to talk about that. And as soon as I sat down, this shit happened.
But we did hit some of the same topics.
Very few, man. We ended up on our own journeys and
talking about our lives. But that's the thing. Like, I feel like because we have had such a wide range of experiences that people can make connections.
I hope so. Yeah, that's why I let it. That's why I don't stop us.
Yeah,
that's why I let it happen.
Because we don't have a script. But now, if we say, "Hey, we're going to talk about The Exorcist," we start talking about it, and then we go off on tangents or Star Wars.
Yeah.
But you know, this is real. This is a real conversation of the famous movie from the early 80s, My Dinner with Andre, which was the playwright and the actor Wallace Shawn, who was inconceivable from The Princess Bride, where the whole movie is just two guys basically having a conversation. And this guy, was it Andre Gregory, who was a playwright? And he had these crazy stories that held you in, you know, enthralled for this whole movie of these two guys just sitting there having dinner at a restaurant. So
that's true. That's what happened. I mean, if you really... This is what happens in real life, guys, and I hope you have somebody in your life to conversate with, you know, that, I mean, I talk to Jeremy, shout out Pat, Patty, I talk to Pat every single day almost about something or another. He's supposed to be on here to do some politics. I'll have to do one myself tonight. God, Jeremy, so much has happened in this country, I can't believe we're not talking about it, but, you know, we have our own niche to talk about things,
and yeah.
I don't see the point of us touching on that as well as, you know, me and him. So I'm going to do it myself tonight because he can't be around. He's too busy working, unfortunately. So, but so that's enough of this, and I hope you guys enjoyed. And we will come back at you again next week. Not sure if we'll do a movie. We might. I tried to do the toxic masculinity thing because it's a big deal. And I kind of want Jeremy to go home and watch some Andrew Tate interviews so he can tell me, because you know what? You have the same perspective with him, I think, that everybody else does right now. That's seen bits and pieces of him. But I want you to watch a full interview. I want you to watch a full Candace Owens interview with him. And then tell me what you think after that. Or maybe Piers Morgan, maybe. You know, it'll be different. You'll see. It's just not the same thing what everybody's talking about. So, I'm KPC. I'm out. Thank you so much for listening. I hope you guys enjoyed. If you did, if you like this kind of stuff, you like hearing our personal lives and being very real, tell us, because we don't have to. We really shouldn't, but we still do anyway. I don't know. We let out so many secrets here, man. I don't know. Anyway, I'm KPC. I'm out. Jeremy, I will see you next week, my brother.
Next time.
Peace out, guys.
Peace out.